Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman. Coming up on today's program, an exclusive interview with Herman Cain's wife, or possibly his widow, depending on how that meeting with her today goes. Then we are joined by UC Davis Police Chief Annette Spicuzza. Also, highlights from Sunday evening's Hollywood Christmas Parade, which was hosted by our very own Eddie Pepitone and musical guest Will Ryan. And don't forget, Eddie Pepitone's new CD, A Great Stillness, is available for download on iTunes. A great holiday gift. Speaking of holiday gifts, all week we've been hearing reports of gunfire, pepper spray, and tasers at Walmarts throughout America. Sounds like Walmart is starting to treat customers as if they were employees. Burger King announced a new recipe for their French fries, which will now be thicker with a crisper coating, just like your arteries if you eat them. Meanwhile, Wendy's fries now offer quote-unquote artisan toppings. The toppings are called artisan because there's a good chance one of them might be Vincent van Gogh's ear. The ACLU says Apple's new iPhone will not assist customers in locating abortion clinics. No surprise for iPhone users who've always known it's impossible getting any service when you want to go through a tunnel. I did that joke. It's the holiday season. Presidential candidate Herman Cain meets today with his wife to ask her two questions. One, do you want me to drop out? And two, what's your name again? All this after Cain's poll numbers dropped to single digits in Iowa. Apparently, people from Iowa don't mind raising pigs, they just won't elect one. It's been a bad week for Cain. A new woman came forward claiming she had a 13-year sexual relationship with him. Cain issued an emphatic denial, saying, "Who are you going to believe, me or a woman so dishonest she carries on a 13-year affair with a married businessman?" Cain does admit to giving his latest accuser financial help, but Cain insists he gives a lot of women financial help, especially when they keep their mouths shut. Contributions to Cain's campaign have plummeted. You know, only in the GOP would Herman Cain be considered unelectable because of adultery and not because he thinks the Taliban is in Libya. Cain's campaign could be over by next week. It's up to his wife. So for more on this, we are joined now by Mrs. Herman Cain, Sylvia Cain. Sylvia Cain, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
What have you told him?
You know, he's a very powerful man. Godfather Pizza is now a household. You order Godfather Pizza. They call Godfather Pizza. That is because of my husband, Herman. And look at the condition of our country. It is as if the business has failed. There needs to be someone to make this a successful country the way it was and respected. And that's what he did with Godfather Pizza.
We've never had a president before whose first job in government was president. This is not an entry-level position. This is president of the United States.
I understand what you're saying. I understand where you're going with this. Look at where this country is. People are occupying. And you know what our country is full of? Customers. Customers that are not satisfied, that are unhappy, that are not getting what they need. My husband's philosophy has always been the customer is always white.
Some have suggested that he doesn't know who the president of Uzbekistan is. He said that the Taliban was in Libya, that he may not know enough about world affairs to...
Maybe Herman screwed up a couple of times. Oh, Libya and the Taliban and Uzbekistan. Yeah, you know, maybe he made a couple of mistakes. He will surround himself, as he always has, with the smartest, brightest, most capable people. And some of those people, I just want to say right now, happen to be women.
Well, let's speaking of foreign affairs, do you mind if I bring up your marriage?
Mm-hmm. We have a terrific marriage. Terrific.
And he's a good husband.
The best. I could not ask for a better husband.
Are you aware of these women who are now coming forward?
Oh, am I aware? Have I heard? Molly Matlin's herd. They see a powerful man who's very wealthy and very smart. They see a ticket, a meal ticket, no pun intended, but it is a meal ticket.
And he's a kind man.
He would call. He would say, listen, Sylvia, this young woman, she's new in the restaurant business. She needs advice. I have to run to this dinner. I said, fine, you know, whatever you need to do. Did you take your Prevacid? You know, he has a terrible stomach. Terrible. But terrible.
Now, you've heard of Gloria Allred, right?
Gloria Allred. Gloria Allred. I'm sorry, no.
Now, a new woman. Have you heard of Ginger White?
Who?
Ginger White. She is an Atlanta businesswoman who came forward this week.
Ginger White, Ginger.
She says that she's had a 14-year affair with Herman Cain.
Ginger. Well.
Ginger White, she never worked in the Restaurant Association.
She's
from Georgia. She claims that Herman and she would rent a room at the St. Regis Hotel in Buckhead, Georgia, near your home. And they carried on a 14-year affair that was based solely on physical and emotional attachment, nothing to do with money, nothing to do with business. Have you seen this woman?
Well, give me the name. I have Herman's. He left his cell phone home. Again, as usually, so absent-minded. Give me that name again.
Ginger White.
Spell it.
W-H-I-T-E.
White. That figures. Let me look here. Ginger White, 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 White. W-W-W, White. White. Did you say Ginger? Did you say Ginger White?
Ginger White.
You said Ginger White?
Yes.
Ginger White. Goddamn Ginger White! He is out at the goddamn St. Regis goddamn hotel while I'm sitting here hollering for him to get his ass home! The son of a bitch! I am sick of this with his goddamn mustache and his stupid glasses! I can't do this anymore! I am done with this I have to hang up right now. I can't even. I'm so goddamn son of a bitch with a fucking ass!
Thank you, Sylvia Cain.
Oh, it's been such a pleasure. Thank you. Do you know when this will air?
As part of its continuing commitment to humorless programming, National Public Radio presents That's Not Funny with your host, Skylar Umbridge.
Hi, I'm Skylar Umbridge. Welcome to That's Not Funny. My first guest is Fred Donahue, and he certainly has a unique profession.
Yes, I am a food tester. I test food for zaniness. For the sake of consumers, I determine if certain food products are as wacky as they claim to be.
That's very interesting. And you're going to do a live demonstration for us.
Yes, I have here a jar of Fluffernutter marshmallow spread.
That sure sounds like a wacky product.
Yes, it does. I will taste it now. Well, I'm only sensing a medium level of whimsy. It's lacking the robust irreverence of the 83 Nutter Butter Peanut Butter Sandwich Cookie.
That is valuable consumer information.
Yes, and now I am going to taste test a Nutrageous bar. Well, I must say the Nutrageousness is really coming through quite distinctly.
Excuse me, but I'm willing to put up with nuttiness. I'm willing to put up with outrageousness, but there's no place for nutrageousness in this studio. That's not funny. Get out! Get out! My next guest on That's Not Funny is Clarence Lewis, who is a singer-songwriter with a politically satirical bent.
Yes, I sing satirical songs that poke fun at the foibles and follies of American political life. Here's a piece I wrote that skewers the Republican presidential field. Everybody's tuning in to see the candidates in the GOP. The primary season is about to begin. I really wonder who's gonna win. Because I do, I wonder.
That's it. That's the whole song.
Yeah, you can see the wonder in my face. You know, we really don't know who's going to win the race, do we?
Yeah, I guess.
I'm not afraid to speak truth to power. I'm sorry if I ruffled some feathers with that one. Here's a song I wrote that takes on the whole Herman Cain thing.
Well, that is certainly a ripe area for satire. Go ahead.
Herman Cain has certainly amassed charges for women who say they were harassed. Many are saying he should be axed, but I don't like to pass judgment until I've seen all the facts.
So, your satirical take on Herman Cain is,
Well, that it would be irresponsible for me to offer an opinion about his situation one way or the other at this point.
And yet you wrote a song about it.
Of course, as a satirist, I couldn't resist the Herman Cain story. And if you'll please indulge me, I'd like to perform my musical takedown of the Koch brothers.
Oh, the Koch brothers. Yes, absolutely.
I should warn you, I'm taking no prisoners with this one.
Please go ahead.
The Koch brothers are behind the scenes of one of the biggest political machines. There's much to be said about all their dealings, but I won't say it because it might hurt their feelings.
Wow, you're very considerate of the political targets you take on.
Yes, as a political satirist, I believe that if you don't have anything nice to say, just don't say it.
I thought you said you were taking no prisoners.
Well, there wasn't a single reference to taking prisoners in that song. It wasn't even about prison or prisoners, so I clearly delivered on my promise.
I have to say, for a political satirist, you're a bit odd.
Well, I'm sorry if my songs are a little too edgy for you, Skylar Umbridge. You usually kick people off your show, but I'm gonna beat you to it. I'm outta here.
That was awkward. And speaking of awkward, my next guest on That's Not Funny was visiting me for Thanksgiving, and I thought I'd have him on so he could finally see for himself what I do for a living. Please welcome my dad, Tyler Umbridge. Welcome, Dad.
Boy, you're not exactly Cokie Roberts, are you?
Dad.
Yep, your mother and I had high hopes for you. Just imagine how happy we were when you changed your major at school from law to liberal arts.
Dad, please.
Who wants a daughter on the Supreme Court when she can be the host of a show that airs in the middle of the afternoon on a station that has fewer listeners than a ham radio?
Dad, we went over all this at Thanksgiving.
Ladies and gentlemen, since this is NPR, I should point out that Skylar Umbridge's college education was made possible by a grant from the Skylar's parents flushing money down the toilet foundation.
Dad, please, let's not rehash all this.
I wanted a son. I always wanted a son. But after your birth, your mother stopped sleeping with me.
Dad, why are you bringing all this up on the air? This is private stuff.
What could be more private than your radio show?
That's not funny.
No. Nothing funny about living to be my age and looking back on a life filled with nothing but disappointment.
Well, folks, now you have some insight as to where I got my humorlessness from. Thank you for joining us on That's Not Funny.
What? What did I say?
That's not funny, Dad.
Come on, honey, man up.
It's really not.
Grow a pair.
Can you just get out, please?
Frank Conniff, you and Eddie Pepitone just covered the Hollywood Christmas Parade for the Hallmark Channel, so how'd it go?
All things considered, I think it went okay. I had fun.
The critics thought Eddie was a little off his game that night.
Oh, I don't think so. Eddie was Eddie.
Now, I heard something horrible happened to the band leader from Pepitone tonight, Chris Pina.
Yes, Chris is in a coma.
Oh my God, what happened?
Eddie sent Chris out to get him a cup of coffee, and Chris got run over by the Batmobile.
How do you get run over by a car going 5 miles an hour?
Nobody knows. Eddie feels terrible about it.
Well, I don't blame him.
No, I mean, Eddie's pissed off that he never got his coffee.
Well, Frank, for those of us who weren't there, why don't you give us a little taste of the Hollywood Christmas Parade as you and Eddie saw it?
Of course, David. Here it is, folks. A few minutes to whet your appetite of the Hollywood Christmas Parade.
Have a holly jolly Christmas. And when you walk down the street, say hello to friends you know. Everyone you meet,
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 81st Annual Hollywood Christmas Parade. I'm Frank Conniff, along with our band leader, Chris Penna, and of course, the star of Eddie Pepitone tonight, Eddie Pepitone.
Thanks, Frank. You're looking good tonight.
Thanks, Eddie. You too.
I'm not used to seeing you without your straitjacket.
Eddie, I was in rehab a long time ago, and they didn't put me in a straitjacket.
It's nothing to be ashamed of, Frank. We've all been locked up in a rubber room to keep from hanging ourselves. Right, folks?
Eddie, this is a parade. Children are watching the show.
I know that. And who's that broad sitting in the booth with us?
That's not a woman, Eddie. That's Chris Penna.
Is that you, Chris?
Yeah, Eddie, it's me.
Jeez, that's a tremendous outfit you're wearing.
Thanks, Eddie.
You look like Lawrence of Arabia right after the Bedouins caved into his demands and finally agreed to molest him.
Eddie, like I said, this is a children's Christmas show.
I heard you the first time, Frank. I know this is a Hallmark special. How the hell did they get their own channel? They can't even make a funny birthday card.
Hey, Eddie, here comes Marie Osmond. She's the Grand Marshal of the Christmas Parade.
She looks great. Hey, Marie, who does your makeup? Benjamin Moore?
Eddie.
She must have gotten up early in the morning so all three coats would be dry by tonight.
You know, Eddie, Marie Osmond's been performing professionally ever since she was 3 years old on the Andy Williams Show.
Andy Williams has cancer.
I think she's an attractive woman.
Well, Chris, you'd fall in love with an open can of spackle.
Eddie, look, here comes the Pete Wilson Regional High School Marching Band doing their version of Winter Wonderland.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite songs about snow.
They've been practicing all semester to be here tonight.
All that hard work and they still sound like a marching band.
I think they sound great, Eddie.
Do they, Chris? Do they really?
Yeah, kind of, yeah.
I'm going to ask you one more time, Chris. One more time. That marching band, what do you think of them?
They sound bad.
What?
They sound bad.
Again.
Bad.
How bad?
Terrible.
Are you asking me or telling me?
They sound like crap.
Is that all?
They sound like a big pile of crap.
Do you mean it?
Yes.
Don't lie to me, Chris Penna. I hate liars.
I mean it. Eddie, I do.
Don't tell me, Chris. Tell them.
Do I have to?
Tell them now.
You guys stink.
Again.
You guys stink.
Tell them why, Chris.
You guys can't play for sh**.
Eddie, think of the children.
I'm sorry, folks. Chris Penna doesn't know what he's saying. He hates Christmas.
Eddie, did you know the Hollywood Christmas Parade started in 1928 and has continued every year since, except for 3 years during World War II?
Oh, my father was a Marine in World War II.
Oh, was he? I didn't know that.
Yeah, after the war, while my mother cleaned office buildings, my dad brought home hookers.
Hey, Eddie, look, it's Eric Estrada.
Chris, run out and get me a cup of coffee.
But there's coffee right there, Eddie.
I want a coffee from Starbucks.
You hate Starbucks coffee, Eddie.
I know. It's ironic. Go get it.
Eddie, how is Chris supposed to get Starbucks with the streets blocked off?
What are you talking about? He can cut right across the street.
You're not supposed to cross the street during the parade.
Who made up that rule? I want a Starbucks grande mocha with whole milk and plenty of sugar.
Okay, Eddie.
And a raisin scone.
You hate scones.
Again, an unexpected turn of events. Move!
Here come the bagpipes. That music reminds me of the time I visited Scotland.
It reminds me of how much I hate Craig Ferguson.
But isn't this a wonderful event, Eddie? Mom and Dad are reliving their childhoods through the eyes of their children while remembering their own parents taking them to this parade long ago.
Hey, folks, I haven't seen Frank Conniff this happy since he found that bottle of scotch duct taped behind his filing cabinet.
And right on schedule, there's Whitney Cummings down on the street ready to describe the action on the curb. Whitney.
Hey, Frank.
Hey, Whitney. Having fun down there?
You bet.
Hey, Whitney.
Hey, Eddie.
I didn't recognize you standing up.
What was that, Eddie?
How the Christ did she ever get two shows?
Whitney worked really hard for those shows, Eddie.
I'm sure, Frank. She had to pretend Chelsea Handler was funny.
Whitney, Wednesday nights on NBC at 8:30. it's the Batmobile.
Going 5 miles an hour. Color me impressed.
And here comes Chris with Eddie's coffee. Oh no, somebody just pushed Chris in front of the Batmobile. Chris, look out!
Somebody, quickly! The Batmobile just ran down that Arab woman. Whitney, Wednesday nights at 8:30 on NBC.
Eddie, my God, Chris has been run over by the Batmobile.
It's his own fault.
Still, though, I feel awful.
Relax, Frank. It's not really the Batmobile. It's just a replica.
Coming up on our show, an exclusive interview with UC Davis Police Chief Annette Spicuzza.
Have a holly jolly Christmas. And when you walk down the street.
Will Ryan and the Cactus County Cowboys, the band that won the West, will be at the world-famous Coffee Gallery backstage in Altadena, California, Thursday, December 8th, with special guest the Rifleman's Johnny Crawford.
That's right, Davey.
And what do you have for us today?
Pacifica is predicated upon peace,
mm-hmm.
So I thought I should do a peaceful song.
Great.
I've got a simple plan, easy as can be. Just a modest little proposal for planetary unity. If everybody played the ukulele, imagine all the happiness it'd be. Peace and joy would reign, and no one would complain. If everybody played the ukulele, if everybody played the ukulele, doesn't take a genius to foresee we'd be harmoniously linked, so war would be extinct. If everybody played the ukulele. Now some folks think it's a crazy dream that can never, ever, ever come true. But nowadays, hey, you never can tell. It's amazing what people will do. So go ahead and play the ukulele and tell the same to each and every friend. Then we will all begin a trend that nobody'll ever wanna end. If everybody played the ukulele. Now some folks think it's a crazy dream that can never, ever, ever come true. But nowadays, hey, you never can tell. It's amazing what people will do. So go ahead and grab what you can. Tell the same to each friend and we will all begin a trend. Yeah, nobody will ever want to end it. Everybody played the ukulele. I said if everybody played the ukulele.
Fantastic. Once again, fantastic. Will Ryan and the Cactus County Cowboys, the band that won the West, next Thursday, December 8th, at the world-famous Coffee Gallery backstage in Altadena, California. Thanks, Will.
Thanks, Davey. Adios, folks.
This week, the Senate passed a bill giving our military the right to hold terrorist suspects indefinitely, even if they're American citizens. Because if we've learned anything from the Occupy Wall Street protests, American citizens can always trust the people in charge to keep a watchful eye on our constitutional rights. Eddie Pepitone reports.
Tuesday, the Senate passed a bill allowing our military to detain American citizens indefinitely if they are believed to be terrorism suspects. Joining us for insight and analysis is our constitutional law consultant, UC Davis Police Chief Annette Spicuzza. Thanks for being here.
And thanks for pronouncing my name correctly.
Spicuzza.
No, Annette. I can't tell you the number of UC Davis students who pronounce it scum bucket.
I want to ask you about the pepper spray incident.
Listen, Bridget Jones's diary. You ask me, Police Chief Annette Spicuzza, any questions about pepper spray, and I'll shove my fist so far up your fart pistol you'll be tasting fingernail polish for a week.
Well, Police Chief Annette Spicuzza, you seem stressed.
Don't shed a tear for Annette Spicuzza. Unless she just pepper sprayed your retinas. I'm just playing with you. I hate pepper spray.
That's a relief.
Pepper spray is for pussies. Police Chief Annette Spicuzza's more a billy club kind of gal.
Police Chief Annette Spicuzza, don't you think we're giving the military too much license allowing them to hold terrorist suspects indefinitely? These are American citizens.
You know as well as I do, there are citizens and then there are citizens. And according to Police Chief Annette Spicuzza's playbook, not everyone's entitled to habeas corpus.
Habeas corpus.
That's what I said. Habeas corpus.
And that's all the time we have. We've been talking to UC Davis Police Chief Annette Spicuzza.
Police Chief Annette Spicuzza never had time for dolls and makeup. You want to see a woman? I'll show you a woman. Where are my rubber gloves?
Thank you for joining us. Ow! You're hurting me!
Say my name! Say my name!
Police Chief Annette Spicuzza! Police Chief Annette Spicuzza!
I can't hear you! Say my name!
Police Chief Annette Spicuzza! Stop! You're hurting me!
This is Paul Dooley, and welcome to Dooley Noted. Today we're chatting with Hollywood legend and super agent, Barry Pretzelman.
Paulie, sweetheart, thank you for having me here. You're a very talented man. I'd like to represent you.
Barry, you already are my agent.
My God, Booby, that was easy. I'll have my assistant send you a paperwork in the morning to make it official.
Barry, you've been my agent for 25 years. We don't need to sign any papers.
Of course not, sweetheart, because that's the kind of relationship we have. No need for a contract. Based on trust, a handshake deal.
You know, we already have a written contract.
More proof that I have your best interests at heart, you fabulous Gentile.
Then why haven't you gotten me any work?
What are you talking about? I just got you a tryout on the X Factor.
No, that was the X Factor. It was just some old Jewish guy sitting around going, ech.
Forget that, Boychick. You're up for a major role on a new cable series about blood-sucking gangsters during Prohibition. It's called Boardwalk Vampire.
I'll do it.
Good, but just so you know, every week Steve Buscemi sucks on your neck. It's perfect. He already has the fangs.
Look,
I'm pitching you to star in a remake of Tootsie. You'll play an actor who can't find work, so he dresses up as a man.
But I am a man.
That's the worst acting I've ever seen.
But I've been playing men my whole life.
Exactly your problem, Dollface. You're getting typecast.
Barry, I don't think you're listening to what I'm saying.
Of course, Paulie. Whatever you want.
Not sure this is working out, Barry.
Is that you talking again? Listen, Schmuck, they're remaking some Hitchcock classics, and I want to get you into one.
I'd love to star in The Wrong Man.
You're not right for it. But I can't stop thinking about you in Rope.
They're remaking the movie Rope?
No, I'm just a kinky bastard. But don't worry, I got your gay industrial film about VD, The Man Who Blew Too Much.
Barry, that'll finish my career.
Again? Don't be difficult, sweetie. The good news is Scorsese wants to work with you.
Marty Scorsese?
No, Putz, his nephew Artie Scorsese. He wants you for a prestige movie about orgies in the 19th century.
What's it called?
Gangbangs of New York. Don't worry, we'll get you a stuntman.
I don't think that sounds so good.
That's exactly what I told them, Schmendrick. Hear me out, Brando. Schindler's List.
Barry, I've given it a lot of thought, and maybe it's time we parted company.
We can't part company now. I have to go.
I mean it, Barry. I've had it.
Paulie, sweetheart, you're breaking up. I'll call you later.
You're not on the phone. You're sitting right here in front of me.
Sorry, babe. I'm going through a canyon. Let me call you back. I got Brett Ratner on the other line. He's got the clap again.
That was Super Agent Barry Pretzelman. I'm Paul Dooley, and I'm still out of work.
Today's program featured Paul Dooley, Rick Overton, Eddie Pepitone, Frank Conniff, Judy Gold, Chris Pina, Janie, Haddad Tompkins, Jeremy Kramer, and the music of Will Ryan. We are written by Steve Rosenfield. Thank you, Mr. Rosenfield. Frank Conniff, Guy Nicolucci, Judy Gold, and Ben Zelevansky. We are mixed and engineered by Alex Steen, edited by Darren Ayers, and our production assistant is Alicia Cordova. Our executive producer is Troy Conrad. Special thanks to Alan Minsky, Matt Perez, Ali Lexa, and Jimmy Dore. I'm David Feldman. Please friend me on Facebook. To hear this show again or to check out our podcasts, please go to DavidFeldman.com. From the KPFK studios in Southern California, I'm David Feldman. Thank you for joining us.